percent so that it is remained under the conservation. That percent is in the kinetic term, the faster is in the circular, both circular and circular cyclists.
First one is circular cyclists,
the other
one is
circular. Yeah, there is this half factor, so two terms will come from there, and due to the variation of base psi classical, one term will cancel.
Yeah.
And interaction part will cancel with the base psi to the classical with psi classical.
Yeah, the rest of the terms will cancel by themselves.
So yes, we will need that identity to be there as well.
In the exchange rule, you mentioned if we exchange AI and AJ in the bracket,
yes,
we pick up the factor minus 1 to the power gamma.
Oh, yeah.
So is it valid only for adjacent fields or?
It's valid for any pair of fields.
Any pair.
But what happens is that if you once you specify the rule for adjacent ones, you can also derive it for the point. Okay. So you can specify it for the adjacent fields. Right? Because what happens is that you take it all the way there, exchange and bring it back, right? So the thing that by signs that you pick up in moving them to make them adjacent, they are eventually cancelled. So you can use any pair.
The argument of this consequence is identity.
Consequence of that?
Yes, Q of phi 1, bracket phi 1 to phi n. This identity is?
Yes. Well, that's the identity. So, what are the consequences?
This was the identity you said.
Yeah, and then I wrote down the identity for the square bracket.
Yeah. Okay.
Right? The first block was for the curly bracket, and then from there I wrote down the identity for the square bracket. Right? So, those are related simply by taking the real product of the phi 0.
Phi 0 will give me that curly bracket.
Exactly.
For that,
yeah. So you have to just take the term by term what you get from the identity of the square bracket. Right? After you take the inner product with phi 0, right? You get all the terms that are there in the curly bracket.
So this thing g of this, you just operator
inside
n square bracket or g of something?
No, this is g acting on, so that square bracket is a scale in the Hilbert space, right? G is an operator on the Hilbert space.
Okay.
So if G on that same. The square bracket, however many terms that you have, right, after you take the square bracket, it becomes a state in the single Hilbert space. Right? So G acts on it as an operator. Is this?
Yes.
Any other questions?
In usual gauge field theory, when we consider gauge fixing,
yes.
So gauge fixed action has this BRST symmetry, which knows about the original gauge.
That's right.
So,
yes.
But here this is not the case.
No, there is a BRST symmetry of the gauge fixed action which you can write down. Okay. But the natural formalism that one uses for quantizing strength field theory is what is called the Batalion-Mikulski formalism, where in fact you introduce the hosts before you even gauge fix. So there is a formalism which allows you to introduce the hosts and the anti-hosts and everything that you need to make the measure gauge invariant at the beginning. And to check that it is a correct action, there are certain identities, right, which replaces the condition for gauge invariance. And that's the kind of thing that one uses for strength field theory. But you can do this for the pre-level action that I described, right? If you take the gauge fixed action, it will have its BRST invariance exactly in the way it happens in quantum mechanics. Any other questions? Okay, so let me just say remind you of a few relations that we'll need today. So we have a three-level action. Okay, we have been doing a three-level strength field. Which had the following form, which is 1 over j square. So here some comments that this sum over t actually starts at 3, at 3 level, okay, because 1 and 2 point functions on the sphere are 0. But I have written it this way because it will be useful when you go to calculus. And the 0 means that we have, we are using the curly bracket, contribution to the curly bracket only from the 3 level amplitudes. And I should remind you that from the definition that I was using earlier, I have extracted a factor of 1 over gs square from the definition of psi t. So instead of having sum over gs to the power 2g minus 2, I now have gs to the 2g. Okay, that appears the definition of this curly bracket. So there is 1 over gs square that comes out of the production. Psi here belongs to h minus 1 plus h minus 1. Then we define, phi 1 the square bracket. So this definition in fact is general, so then we can just put to 3-level. We define this. This belongs to h minus 1 plus h minus 3 half, okay? Minus 1 picture and minus 3 half picture. For phi I belonging to h minus 1 plus h minus half. Okay? And we define it by the following relation. Now the relation that phi 0 signal c 0 minus phi 1 to phi n. Is just phi 0. This is for phi 0 belonging to x minus 1 plus h minus half. Okay, and the idea is that if you want to define a state, which this is, it is enough to specify the inner product of the state with every other vector. Right, and that's what we have. And the c 0 minus is needed to make this inner product non-zero, because if this is added by b 0 minus, phi 0 is added by b 0 minus, then you need a c 0 minus to get a non-zero inner product. And then based on this, we derive an identity. Because this identity as it stands will have only 3 level contributions, okay, which are denoted by the subscript 0. And this identity has the following form. I will write down the identity in a slightly different form today, but it's entirely given. Gamma I is, let me remind you, at the Grassmann parity of the phi i's. Okay, so if phi I is Grassmann even, then gamma I is 0. If phi I is Grassmann odd, then gamma I is odd. Gamma I is 1. Plus half sum over L and K equal to 1 to infinity. L from 0 to infinity, L plus K equal to N. Then there is sum. This sum runs over all possible ways of dividing up the set 1 to n into 2 sets. So I call this I1 to IN, J1 to JK, subject to the condition that I1 to IN, U to J1 to JL, so JK, simply the whole set 1 to n. There is a sign factor, which I write sigma I A G B. And here, that is phi I 1 to phi I L. Okay, and at this stage, I am going to write the identity in a slightly different form. G phi J 1 to phi J. Yeah, and these are all computed at three levels. So the form in which you wrote the identity earlier was simply by inserting a complete set of states in front of this term. Okay. Phi r, phi r c.
Okay.
Then this is just a number which comes out of the curly bracket. And then just manipulating things a little bit, okay, by moving the g's around. Okay, this is exactly what I wrote down last time. And this is a sign that is picked up in DRNG G0 minus I12. Equal to that minus half, I put everything on one side. So this is equal to 0. This is equal to 0. And he described where this identity came from. This part is basically omega of qb5. Omega of qb5 by the differential identity is d omega, okay, of 1 over dt. And then we integrated d omega over rgmn, okay, picked up onto the boundary of rgmn. And then we argued the boundary of rgmn is essentially obtained by doing two lower order vertices, and that's this. So this identity essentially comes from the fact that the way we have chosen RCMN or R0MN, because the function is g equal to 0, the way you have chosen R0MN in such a way is such that when you group together all the contributions, you get the full integration over the normalizations. Okay, that's what is encoded in this identity.
Because g is actually identity in Lewis short sector and PCO in the
gamma. Yeah. So G is the identity in the Lewis short sector and the PCO, the zero mode of the PCO in the Lewis short sector. Well, lambda tilde belongs to h minus 1 plus h minus 3 half to post number 1. And lambda belongs to h minus 1 plus h minus half to post number 1. So these are the infinitesimal transformation parameters. Again, it looks a little strange, gauge transformation parameters are supposed to be functions of x. But the way you see this as a function of x is again by expanding in this basis, okay, sum over r, lambda r, phi r. And then noticing that those phi r, sum over r, they are also included in integration over momentum. So the gauge transformation parameters that you see here are actually Fourier transform of the regular gauge transformation parameters that you get in position space.
We directly Fourier transform this to position space?
You can, except that these have complicated dependence on momentum. Yeah, the momentum dependence is exponential in these. Yeah, because this is a, you have to make a conformal transformation and as well as the conformal weight of a vortex of water is k square, right? It has k square piece. So the momentum dependence on the vortex is complicated. Right? So you can write in principle in the position space, but it's hard. It will be a new formula. So the exercise also proved this. Yeah, prove that this is invariant under this using this idea. So how many of you did the exercise? Anybody else write it? Let me try to indicate briefly how it goes. So first, the lambda tilde gain invariance is trivial. So lambda tilde you can see appears only here, right? So if you set lambda equal to 0 and test because this is infinitesimal transform, so you can check separately that lambda tilde is symmetric and lambda is symmetric. So on the lambda tilde, only delta psi tilde equal to qb lambda tilde, everything else is 0. Delta psi is 0. Okay. So here you see that if delta psi tilde is qb lambda tilde, in this term you pick up ub g q. Okay, qb of course commutes with g. So you get qb square which is 0. Okay, so this term is manifestly invariant under the lambda tilde gauge transformation. And so is this. Okay? If you put a delta psi tilde equal to qb tilde lambda, qb lambda tilde, right? You can put qb on this side. Okay, just by switching the direction. And then qb can be commuted through c0 minus because as I described, the anti-commutator of qb and c0 minus has no c0 minus. So the matrix element will vanish. So again, you essentially get a qb square which makes it 0.
Say, in the second term of the gauge transformation, when you take the conjugate,
yes,
there the arrangement of length and time will some change or not?
Yeah, there is some change, but there will not be that much change because delta psi tilde.
Will there be any signs?
Yeah, so the first of all, there will be a sign. So it will be, you can write it this way, it will be qb lambda tilde. This is, no sign here, right? This qb, the conjugate of qb lambda. Now you want to make qb act on this side. That will make it a minus sign. Okay, qb is here. Qb is a, is like a charge, right? Like a momentum. Okay, integral, this is the zero mode of a dimension one time. So just like momentum, okay, if it acts on the left, right, you pick up IM value B. If it acts on the left, you pick up IM value minus B. Okay. So similarly, when QB is made to act on the right hand side, you pick up a minus sign. Okay. But at the same time, if you want to put this QB here, okay, lambda tilde is gas or not, it has most number of 1. Okay. So when you want to move QB through lambda tilde, you pick up another minus. Okay, so let me repeat again. There are two minus signs. Okay. One is simply because if, even if qb was a commuting operator, suppose it was just j, okay, where j is some momentum factor. Okay, it is a momentum. So you make the momentum, the operator act not on the left but on the right, okay, you become a minus sign. Is that clear? Mm-hmm. See, you know that the matrix element between the state of momentum p and minus p is also. If you take state of momentum P and take the dpz inner product to another state of momentum P, the result is zero because you are violating momentum by unit of 2. Okay, so P minus P is zero, right? You know that you know this relation. Minus P is not zero. Okay. Now let's see why, how you can prove this. Okay. So you calculate minus P, P hat. P hat acting on this picks up P. Right? But we have to also act on the left. Okay. If acting on the left, it picked up minus p or in problem, right? Because you get minus p times minus 2p. So this should vanish. So when p acts on the left, it actually picks up the negative of that. That the left says carries. Okay, that's because acting on the right and acting on the left differs by sign. So that's the sign, that's one of the signs, because qb, okay, here qb is acting on lambda tilde, but we want to make qb act on this side. Okay, that will pick up a minus sign. Okay. But the very fact that qb is moved physically, okay, in position through lambda tilde, okay, gives another minus sign, which makes it plus. Okay, so this actually is lambda qb.
This is for the VPZ conjugation.
Yeah, all conjugations here are VPZ conjugations.
Ah,
yeah. Okay, we are talking about other conjugation. If you take Hermitian conjugate, then of course I will also change to minus sign, right?
Yes,
so in that case, the this relation will be PP talking about. Okay, so let me repeat again, the lambda tilde transformation is trivially a symmetry of that action. Is that clear? Because only basically it's a property of only the free part. Right? Interacting part involves psi and psi doesn't transform the lambda. So now the question is to check whether the lambda symmetry, the transformation of the lambda, which involves all nonlinear details, whether this is the symmetry of the action. Is this clear?
QB lambda is trivial to
C. Yeah, QB lambda is trivial to C, except that QB lambda appears in several places, so it will, part of it will actually contribute from C. So let's try to calculate delta is 0 or QS square delta is 0. And now I'm writing delta lambda is 0 because we are considering only the lambda gets transformed. Set lambda to equal to 0. So the first term will be minus psi tilde C naught minus QB delta psi tilde. Yeah, I'm just writing this now. Well, not minus half has gone because there are two psi tildes. Right? Both will give the same result. Okay? It's symmetric actually in the two psi tildes. Then psi tilde C0 minus QB delta psi. And then there will become psi C0 minus QB. Delta psi tilde.
Delta lambda psi tilde.
All is here. Delta lambda. Second term, we have to vary psi tilde as well as psi. Okay. Now, when you vary psi tilde, okay, you might have thought that delta lambda psi tilde will be on the left, but just the VPZ conjugation, you can make it like this. And finally, the last term, sum p equal to 1 to infinity, 1 over p minus 1 factorial, psi to p minus 1 lambda, and psi to p minus 1 delta lambda psi. I should have put zeros here, right? Because these are all been done actually there. Yeah, so what happened? 1 by 1 p minus 1 factorial, because there are p psi's inside. So you have to vary each of them. And delta psi in the inside this, because delta psi is commutative, this is just one even. Right? Psi is just one even, delta psi is just one even. So you don't, it doesn't matter where you place delta psi. Okay, that's why psi can be p minus 1, delta lambda psi. Now the claim is that these two terms exactly cancel.
To this part I'll talk.
Yeah, let's see why that happens. So first of all, so lambda tilde is not there. So first, let's look at this term, delta psi equal to qb lambda. There is a term like this. Yeah, so qb squares to 0. So if you take delta lambda psi, the qb lambda, this qb square will be 0, right? So that term doesn't contribute. So the second terms, between psi and psi tilde, they are the same except the psi transpose has x at g. But here you see that this one has an x at g. So those two will exactly cancel. So this and this cancels. Okay, so you don't have to worry about this anymore. So you just have these two terms. So now I substitute the expression for delta lambda psi tilde. Again, you see that delta lambda psi tilde, okay, so that's on this part. Okay, so here I am going to do some manipulations. Okay, at one. So first I extend the position of scissor domain as a two. That picks up a minus sign. Okay, anti-commutator, that's what I've been emphasizing. We do not have a C0 more, C0 minus, and hence the matrix element will vanish. Even though QU is C0 minus, anti-commutator doesn't vanish, right? But it doesn't have a C0 minus. So you pick up a minus sign by bringing QB here. Okay? And then you make QB act on the left. That means you make QB act on psi. And as we discussed, that picks up another minus sign. Okay? Because instead of right, you are making it act on the left. But no minus sign, because no further minus sign, because psi is given. So this, I'll write, so let me write this and then you see if you agree with this. C0 plus. And then I substitute for delta lambda psi tilde, which is so you are left with this term now. So this in fact gives two terms. So delta lambda psi, the first term delta lambda psi is qb lambda. There should be, I think, no G in the first.
Isn't there be G in the first term? Let's see.
I don't think there is a G in the first term.
Sir, this is delta psi tilde.
Yeah, there is delta psi tilde, right? So no G in the first term. Yeah. Okay, there is G in the second term.
Maybe you can use that board, I can bring it.
Okay. Just see if you can.
Yeah.
We did find a piece of cloth somewhere. Mr. Narayan, yeah, you are using. Is it in string area?
String area,
I
think.
Yeah. Yeah.
Clean the cloth off.
Yeah. I think DA secretary is visit me.
This
is
being recorded.
Yeah, I know. So it's on record that we have become too clean. Let me continue. So, we basically are trying to manipulate this. The first term, okay, we will write as a single curly bracket using this. So I'll just clean up a little bit this part. Oh, I should have, I think something went wrong. This sum should have been from 0 to infinity. Okay. Actually, 3 level it doesn't matter. Okay, but just check the notes so I have kept it. Yeah. So those are from 0 to infinity.
Yeah.
Okay. At 3 level it doesn't matter because you equal to 0 term will cancel, right? Because there's no coupon function on the sphere. But that is the point is e equal to 1 to infinity when the, because it's in a curly bracket. In the curly bracket, okay, we started with one element, but in a square bracket you can also have 0 element. Okay, the one point function is non-zero. Yeah, if the one point function is non-zero, right, that corresponds to a curly bracket with one single element. But once you use this relation, right, if the one point function here is non-zero, right, so phi zero is non-zero, then even this square bracket with no element will be non-zero. Okay? It's defined by this definition, right, by this relation. But again, this is not valid, this is not true for sphere. Okay? For sphere, unless there are three points inside the curly bracket, the result is zero. Which means unless there are two entries inside a square bracket, the result will be zero. But I am writing it in general because it will be this extending to higher order. So the last term, okay, what I will do is I will change this p minus 1. Okay, I will call this p. Okay, that's a renaming of variables. So last term I can write from p equal to 0 to infinity. Q equal to 0 to infinity. 1 over 2 factorial times p factorial times psi to the p g and then psi to the q. Sorry, this is a gauge. Variation of x. Okay, so this is g square. And then if you call the includes here. Yeah? All of them are very much there. This is clear. So yeah, basically, we have to show that this is zero. Yeah, because you have to show the gauge invariance of the action. Okay, so you have to show that this is zero. Okay. And to show this, now we are going to make use of this relation. So let us take this relation, this relation over here, and consider the following case. Phi 1 equal to psi, phi 2 equal to psi, so also I have to, phi n minus 1 equal to psi, phi n equal to psi. Okay, and let's see what relation we get. So, from I equal to 1 to n minus 1, okay, in this sum, you will just get a qb sign, because each of the phi i's up to I equal to n minus 1 is just a sign. Okay. And this qb sign can be moved to the front, because all the other phi's are just one given variables, right? They are all signs. Okay. Phi n, which is lambda, is sitting at the end anyway, okay? So you are not going to move it through them. So, you will basically get the first term will be n minus 1 times qb psi psi to be n minus 1 lambda. This is clear? This is the first n minus 1 times. Okay, that's why there is n minus 1 time. Then, there will be a factor of psi n minus, sorry, this should be psi n minus 2, psi n minus 2, because there are n minus 1 psi's to begin with, right? On one of them q be acting, right? So there are n minus 2 psi's left over, okay, there is a qb psi and then there is a lambda. Okay, so because altogether you have to have n n, right? That's what we have used. So one integer, n minus 2 integer, and the one integer. This is psi to the n minus 1 qb lambda. And finally, this term. Okay, all these factors are all 1. Okay, because up to gamma I minus 1, so gamma 1, gamma 2, up to gamma I minus 1 are all just 0. So they all are common, right? Except the lambda is sitting at the very end. So here, there are going to be two kinds of terms that will come. This lambda is spatial. All the rest are psi. Okay. Now lambda could be included in this set or in this set. Okay? Or to divide, right? Lambda could be included in this set or in this set. Okay. But it's easy to show that those two contributions are actually identical. Okay, it's easy to show if you use the representation that I used last time by inserting a complete set of states. Okay. Then you can check that whether you insert lambda here or lambda here, they are identical. And that means that we can choose to insert lambda here and move this factor of half. Okay, half the terms will have lambda sitting in this part, and the other half of the term, lambda will be sitting in this part. Okay, so we'll choose so that lambda is sitting always in this part. Okay, get rid of the half. Then what is the structure of the term? If we write the structure of the term, then it will become clear. So the structure of the term will be that there are factors of phi here, and then n minus 1 minus r factors of phi here. If r factors of phi here come, n minus 1 minus r factors of phi here come. Okay? So sum over r equal to 0 to n minus 1. Here will be psi to the r g psi to the n minus 1 r times lambda.
But if l is equal to 0, say, if I want to I,
yes,
then that term occurs only once, right? The lambda will occur, or it could sit outside. Probably not.
Well, if n is equal to 0,
right?
Yeah, it could sit outside also, because this curly bracket with nothing is also allowed, right? See, in general, on sphere it's not allowed. Okay, on the sphere you don't have to worry about this.
Suppose I take k is equal to capital N and l is equal to 0.
If you take, yes, that's one term, k equal to capital N and l is equal to 0, yes.
In that
so
case,
nothing will happen, sit here.
Yeah, so lambda is inside in that case.
Yeah, lambda is inside, exactly.
That is only a unique term, right? There is no half cancellation there then.
Yeah, yeah, but the point is this k and l particle summed over.
Oh,
so
other extreme.
Exactly. Other extreme will be we have lambda here.
Okay.
Right? Yeah, everything here and there's nothing inside.
Nothing inside. Okay. So that may not be allowed on the sphere, but in general it's allowed.
Exactly. Which is on the sphere not allowed, not allowed.
Yeah.
So when the first one is allowed, the second one is also allowed. Because in terms of curly bracket is the same expression. Right? So you are saying that it just cancels the factor of half.
Yeah.
So either it both come or nothing.
Yeah, because we need at least three fields inside the curly bracket.
Yeah, for the sphere.
For the sphere.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, but in general that is not true, right? And I have written it this way so that it's also higher in general. Okay, so is this clear? We pick r factors of psi here and the rest here. Okay. But there is a commutative factor you have to remember, because you have n minus 1 size to begin with, right? And you are picking R of it. Okay, n minus 1 size are arranged in this. Here, you are supposed to sum over all possible sets, right? This is for when the phi's are all different, right? That's a general form. Now you have chosen the phi's to be identical, but still the fact that you can choose different sets are still there, right? Which means that you have to multiply it by the number of ways. You can choose R size out of the n minus 1 size.
Okay.
So there is n minus 1 choose R multiply this. So this is 0. Okay. Now multiply by 1 over n minus 1 factorial and sum over n. First term gives you sum over n, 1 over n minus 2 factorial at least 1, because you started with n elements inside a curly bracket and lambda is 1 of them, right? By reference. So even if there are no size inside n, the sum over n has to start at 1. But in this term particularly, okay, of course the n equal to 1 term is 0. Okay, you can have a negative part of psi, right? But you can keep it here anyway, you can use the fact that minus 1 factorial is infinity. You think of the gamma of minus 1 and hence this is 0. So I can just formally write then write the sum from 1 to infinity. Okay, even though it's understood that in this term sum really starts from any problem. Okay, then n equal to 1 to infinity, 1 over n minus 1 factorial So you see, this n minus 1 choose r, that becomes 1 over r factorial times n minus 1 minus r factorial. N minus 1 factorial, which was out in the numerator, gets cancelled against this. So this is zero. So here I can just redefine things a little bit. I use m equal to n minus 1 minus r. Okay. I think of the sum as independent sum over m and r. Instead of having sum over n and sum over r from 0 to n minus 1. I think of this as an independent sum over m and r. So this term, last term, I can in fact write as sum over m equal to 0 to infinity, sum over r equal to 0 to infinity, 1 over m factorial, 1 over r factorial, psi to the r, and now if you compare term by term here, you can easily verify that after some shift in the variables, these terms are in what one corresponds to the terms here. So in our instance, I have made some error here, I can see that this should have been p equal to 0 to infinity. So I'll leave it. Since I've erased everything, you have to check where this thing. Yeah. Okay, this is not, because clearly there is a term qv psi times psi to the 0. Okay, qv psi times lambda and 0 for not on the sphere but on the general demands up to this term. Yeah. Okay, so if you just follow the derivation carefully, you should check. You should see that this sum is from 0.
This was from the first term, the psi lambda.
Yeah, probably it's from that example. Yeah, UV psi inner product, right? With this, yeah, E equals 0. Anyway, so you can check that these three terms are exactly in one correspondence with this term, and this term. Is this clear? So this is the way one proves gauge independence of the action. Yeah, because the point is, here, n runs from 1 to infinity, r runs from 0 to n minus 1. That means m, this object, that once you sum over n, okay, this index can go anywhere from 0 to infinity. Okay, that's what it is saying. Okay, it cannot be negative because r has upper bound to n minus 1. Okay, so the independent sum, okay, so here the sum over r is dependent, okay, that's why you get this change of variable. Once you make m as an independent variable, then m and r are independent sum. So now let me go to quantum theory. So here, the full quantum theory I'll not do. Okay, if I have time at the end, I'll try to do this. But let me just state the result, at least for the full quantum theory. So the action for the full quantum theory is the following. Okay, this is more or less identical to what we had for 3 level, right? Except that the 0 subscript has been wrong. Okay, otherwise, it's exactly the same structure of the action. There is, however, some crucial difference. Psi belongs to h minus 1 because it's minus half for all those numbers. And psi tilde belongs to h minus 1 plus h minus 2 half. They are all the same.
So b0 minus b0 plus b0.
No gauge condition. We are not using any gauge condition. This is a gauge invariant. Analog of a gauge invariant diagram. So this is supposed to be the full gauge invariant action for quantum state. Now, of course, there are several things which are puzzling here, right? And first of all, we have field contains all those numbers. Okay? Now, as I have been emphasizing, the states of host number 2 are the physical classical fields. Okay? The states, the fields, the psi's which carry other host numbers are the hosts that come from gauge fixing that classical gauge invariants. Okay? So, I want to explain that the hosts, if you include in the action, that should represent gauge fixed action, right? Not gauge invariant action. When you write down the Lagrangian for electrodynamics, right? We don't write down ghosts, right? Or when you write down the Lagrangian for QCD, we don't write down ghosts. The ghost comes when you gauge fix QCD. Okay? However, here the ghost comes when you follow gauge fix. Okay? And this, in fact, is the key ingredient of what people call the Bartholomew-Mikulski quantization. Okay? So, this is the leading quantization. Okay. Where ghosts are introduced and anti-ghosts. The second puzzle is that these vortices now receive contribution not only from genus 0 but also higher genus. Again, this is not something that you normally would think of in a consistent gauge theory, right? You write down the classical action. And then in quantum theory, you calculate the quantum effective action, but it's not that every loop order you keep adding new terms. Well, sometimes you have to keep adding new terms for ultraviolet regularities. Okay, through counter terms. But that's not a problem here. Right? String theory has no ultraviolet divergence. Okay? So one would expect that you write down the classical action once and for all and then they would do quantizing. Okay? You shouldn't have to add anything at quantum level. Okay? And again, this is a hallmark of BV. okay, what I call is quantization. That if the quantum measure is not invariant under Gauss transformations, it only knows about it and corrects it. So this extra term that you are adding, which is beyond cyclic T0, which is beyond the classical T11 term, are the correction term that you have to add to the action to compensate for the fact that the measure of integration over psi is not being invariant. Okay. So I should write here that here rho's and anti-rho's are introduced before Gauss fixing, and so are corrections needed for so this means that somehow this quantization formalism already knows about the measure. Okay? Because we are saying that it corrects for the non-impedance of the measure. Normally when you write down a Lagrangian for a Gauss theory, it's a QCD. We don't know what the measure is, right? Measure is what you introduce in the path integral, okay, as a function integral. Okay, not it's not something that is given to you from the beginning. However, here, okay, as this implies that you are including correction factors terms to correct for the law impedance of the measure, this implies that you already know that the measure is not invariant under appropriate Gauss transformation, right? So how do you know what the measure is? The way you know what the measure is that in this set of variables, measure is simply a linear measure. Okay? And that comes from the fact that there is a natural symplectic form in the space of fields. Okay? And this symplectic form is what you get from the inner product. Okay? If you take two vectors, A and B, right, then A C naught minus B defines an anti-symmetric inner product between A and B. Okay? And that inner product, okay, you can think of this as a symplectic form that is introduced in the tangent space of this space of size. Right? Because size take value in all those numbers. Right? And in that space, okay, you are introducing a symplectic form to the inner product, A C naught minus B. Okay? And so once you have a symplectic form, there is a natural measure, it is a phase space measure. Okay? It's like having a Q and P, and then a phase space measure is simply integral dQ by dt. Okay? So once you have written the action, okay, and you have the symplectic form, okay, through the inner product, you already have a measure. Okay? And so it makes sense to ask for what corrects that measure. Okay? And these will turn out to what corrects that measure. So one can start with this action, quantize it, and get a fully consistent quantum theory. And the fiber and rules that one derives from this.
We have written it in the form of inner product that already fixes the measure.
Yes, so your point is that this inner product, that if you take so here you have two sets of fields. But let's ignore the psi tilde for a minute. Actual story is a little more complicated than this. So otherwise we have this delta psi C0 minus delta psi prime. Okay. Suppose you get two arbitrary variations, delta psi and delta psi prime. Okay. So you can define a symplectic form by this inner product. Okay. Delta psi C0 minus delta psi prime. So given any two variations, delta psi and delta psi prime, you can define a quadratic form by this inner product. And what I am saying is that quadratic form has a property of symplectic term. So this is the measure that one uses. Okay, in the space of fields. Okay, that means you can identify half of the fields as momentum, half of the fields as position. Okay, Qs and Ps. So okay, these are not the positions of momentum in the usual sense. But like Q and P, and then you write the integration measure as integral dQi over dti, right? The standard phase space integral. Okay. So already the information about what the integration measure is contained in the action and this separately. Okay, that's the reason why you can even begin to correct the action even at this level. Right? Otherwise, there is no sense of correcting the action, right? Because you don't know what the weather is. How do you know what term you should add to correct for the weather?
You're saying for the humidity or humidity, we don't have this separating measure, right?
Not the way you normally write down the action. Right? After you have written the QCD action, for example, you still have a choice of different measures. There of course UV finiteness and so on, the renormalizability and so on gives you consent on what kind of measures you have. Otherwise, the choice of measure, different gauge invariant measures will correspond to adding different gauge invariant hard invariant terms to the action. You could do that in principle, right? And change the theory, except that those theories will not be normalized. Here you don't have that choice. Right? The structure of the action is completely fixed, right? Which means measure is also fixed. Yes.
Where are the antifields?
So antifields are also inside this stuff. Because the antifields are like the momentum conjugate to the fields. Okay. So all states of Bose number 2 and below, you think of as fields. And the states of Bose number 3 and above, you think of antifields. Okay, and you can see that this inner product pairs states of Bose number 2 and below with states of Bose number 3 and above. Okay? Because the Bose number of delta psi and delta psi prime has to add up to 5. Okay? So that's all you see, 0 minus. Yeah.
So for a given renormalizable theory, yes, is the measure for path integral unique?
No, not for a given renormalizable. Once you demand renormalizability of the theory, then it is true. Okay. See, the point is what two different measures will correspond. Suppose you have two different measures to the gauge invariant, right? Then the difference can be exponentiated, and you can think of this as adding a term in the action. Right? If you have one measure, f of psi d psi versus g of psi d psi, right? You can always write g of psi equal to f of psi times exponential log of g of psi over f of psi, right? And the log of g of psi over f of psi, you can think of as a term in the action. So if f and g are both gauge invariant, then this ratio is also gauge invariant. Right? So changing a measure, preserving gauge invariance, will correspond to essentially adding gauge invariant terms to the action. And typically when you write down an action, you write down almost no gauge invariant terms.
Yeah.
Right? So then after that there's no further freedom. Okay, unless you're willing to add non-numbers.
Yeah, so this is, so this uniqueness in this sense is the reason behind, I mean, because as you said that how can we know the measure before even quantizing?
The question is not about renormalizability. Ritual is finite, right?
Okay, yeah, there is
okay.
No question.
But the point is that you, even though it's finite, right, you cannot just add arbitrary terms. There's no other gauge invariant term, that's what it is saying. Okay. That even though the renormalizability is not the issue, the gauge invariance constant is so tight that you cannot simply deform the action by adding something else. Now, in this language, in fact, basically, Bathal and Wilcox's quantization, as you could see in that chapter, you will find. Okay, so what we are going to do is to give an indirect proof of gauge invariance. Okay, this is the way you can give gauge invariance on a full quantum theory. Okay. But we will follow an indirect proof, okay, which is also equally good, I mean, it does the job. So for this, let's go back. To the gauge feedback. Quantum action. Okay, which means that in the definition of the Cauchy bracket, you still use that the appropriate terms from marginless that are needed to get the full string amplitude. But you use a dynamic term which is gauge fixed. The C0 by L0 plus L0 1. And then using the Feynman rule, so we have a way of associating once the gauge fixed Lagrangian is given. So from the gauge fixed Lagrangian, we can write down the Feynman diagrams. And as you have seen that those Feynman diagrams are in one-to-one correspondence with certain subspaces of PGMN. Right? But that's the way you constructed those vertices in any way, so that when you put them all together, you get a continuous subspace of PGMN, okay, covering the whole section. But now we construct the one PI effective action by summing over one PI diagrams. Because what are the one PI diagrams in the Feynman diagram language? Suppose you have a 4-point amplitude. So this is one PI. Four external legs joining in the vortex. This will be one PI, one particle irreducible, but this is not. Something like this is not one PI. Okay, so these are okay. This is not okay. Or something like this is not okay. Because one PI diagram has a feature that by cutting one internal line, you can make it into two parts, right? These diagrams are that feature, these diagrams are. So suppose we take the sum over these diagrams. So each of these, each will give a subspace of PG. Okay, where n are the ns sector number of ns and r sector states. Okay, each will give a subspace of PGMN because that's what the Feynman diagrams are designed to do. Okay? Each Feynman diagram generates some subspace of PGMN. This one generates RGMN. Okay? That's the elementary string vortex, that's the definition. Okay, this one generates RGMN, but these will generate, this for example will generate some other subspace of PGMN, okay, and so on. So let's call the union of these subspaces as RGMN 1. Union of these subspaces will be some subspace of PGMN, right?
Union of these subspaces.
The one PI subspaces. The subspaces associated with one PI diagrams. Associated with one PI diagrams. Is clear? So RGMN 1 PI will in particular contain RGMN. Right? Because RGMN is the elementary vortex, okay, getting contribution from all genus in general. This is of course by definition 1 PI. Right? Elementary vortex is always 1 PI. But this is bigger than RGMN. Right? Because there are many 1 PI diagrams like this For example, it's not part of RGM1, but it's not part of RGM1 here. Is this clear? So we define this curly bracket A1 to M. A1 to A1 tilde to M tilde. 1 to I. As integral over RGM 1 to I. Okay, so this is the same differential form that we integrated on the space of our PGMN. So the only difference between this definition and the original curly bracket definition is the original curly bracket definition was integrated over RGMN, the elementary vertices. This is integrated over RGMN 1 prime, okay, which, let me emphasize again, is a bigger subspace of PGMN than RGMN itself.
RGMN doing integral doesn't bring any divergence.
Yes.
But
so here, yeah. So here there will be divergences, but those divergences are associated with loop divergences. Right? It will not contain degenerations where this becomes infinitely small, but it will contain degenerations where this handle is becoming infinitely small. Okay. So RGMN 1 pi is not free from infinite divergence, but it has infinite divergence only that of the kind that comes from loops, okay, not from loops. Is this clear?
RGMN 1 pi, there will be no divergence from the boundary of the modular space.
From the separating type boundary of the modular space. Okay. There will still be, these are also boundary of the modular space. Okay. But these are the boundaries that comes from non-separating type. Now, suppose we now write down a gauge fixed action of the same kind that we wrote down earlier, but replace the interaction vertex, okay, that phi to be p, 0, a 3 level interaction vertex, okay, or the full interaction vertex phi to be p, by phi to be p 1 pi. So, what use is such an action? So the reason that such an action would be useful is because if we take this as your elementary vertex, okay, let's suppose that we have a field theory where this is an elementary vertex. Okay. And now suppose that using this elementary vertex, we calculate all free level diagrams. Okay. That by construction generates the full region of integration in PGM that we want to integrate. Okay, see, it's a simple statement of finite diagrams. Then, if you take the sum of all 1 pi diagrams, okay, define the 1 pi vertex by a sum of all the diagrams, and then use those diagrams and just draw 2-level graphs, then essentially you generate all the graphs. Is this clear? Because this, for example, okay, this is already 3-level. This one will be included in this. Okay, with this replaced by 1 pi. Okay? Because this 1 pi 3-point vertex will already include this diagram. Okay. So one can see easily that if we take the 1 pi vertex, okay, which basically means that you take the 1 pi offset, 1 pi amplitude, and regard that as a vertex, okay, which includes elementary vertex, but which includes more, and then just draw 3-level diagrams, okay, using the 1 pi vertex, you actually generate all 5. So this means that the following action will generate all the finite diagrams of the theory, okay, all the full amplitude of the theory. The action, the gauge fixed action, is take 1 over gs square and then minus half three level graphs of this generates a full amplitude. Is clear? Okay, the full integral, the full section is generated as a combination of RGM and 1 PI and anything that you get by plumbing fixture of RGM and 1 PI. Okay, but the plumbing fixture here involves only this kind of plumbing fixture, never handles. Because all the handles are already included in RGM and 1 PI. So now I claim that phi 1 to phi n 1 to n and phi 1 to phi n 1 to n satisfies identities. Okay, in particular, that big identity that I wrote down are satisfied by these. Okay, but those identities are not satisfied by the full string context where you drop the one. So let me just give the outline argument as to why this is so. And for this, we have to only go back to the argument that I gave for why those identities are valid, right? Where the identities came from. Those identities came from by identifying the boundary of the RGM, right? R0M. Okay. And the key fact that we use is the boundary of RGMN or R0MN must match up with some Feynman diagram, some other Feynman boundary of some other Feynman diagram, okay, so that they fit together. Okay. And the other Feynman diagrams which are to be included are three Feynman diagrams. Okay. Not loops, because that time you are considering three level. But for these, the same identity is ordered. Okay? Because the boundary of this must match up with the boundary of some other Feynman diagram constructed from this 1 PI vertices but using three level diagrams. Right? Not loops. Because you are not supposed to do loops with this 1 PI vertex. All the loop has gone, already gone into the reference of the 1 PI vertex. Okay. So, the identity that we wrote down for three level Cardian square brackets are also valid for the 1 PI Cardian bracket and square bracket. Okay, but those identities are not valid for the full Cardian bracket and square bracket, the quantum Cardian bracket and square bracket, because those also have get contribution to other boundaries where a handle inside the loop shrinks to 0 size.
There is an identity of the identity, so it is like imposed by hand, but saying that I will only remain in tree level. But here the tree level thing is included in the construction.
Exactly. Because here only the tree level diagrams build a full Feynman amplitude. So if you use the 1 PI vortex, okay, the 1 PI regions. So the kind of boundary condition that the 1 PI regions satisfy, that the boundary of RGMN, okay, see what, there you use the fact that the boundary of R0MN is the result of doing two other boundaries of R0MN with lower A magnitude. Right? Exactly the same identity holds here. Okay? Whatever you do two identities, two lower order vertices to get the boundary of R0MN, okay, is valid for R1PI, RGMN 1PI. Because once you have used one pi vortex, you are drawing exactly the same set of diagrams. So what these identities should look like? Basically follows from Feynman diagrams. So you never have to go back to PGM and all, right? Because this is just a combinatorial. Right? The boundary of RGM and what is it composed of, right? It's the boundary, it's some of the boundaries of all the other Feynman diagrams that match on to this boundary. So once you know this, okay, once you know this satisfies the same identity, then it follows automatically that there is a corresponding gauge invariant, one pi effective action, whose gauge fixing will give the action that you have written down there. So this means that there is the gauge invariant one pi effective action. Which is with the usual P-level case invariants and this basically shows that the full quantum theory has gauge invariance. But of course, the gauge transformation laws are a little different. Okay, linear part is the same. But because these definitions have changed, similarly, the square bracket definition has changed, the actual gauge transformation laws of these fields are a little different from what you are talking about. Those you interpret as the quantum corrections of the gauge transformation. I'll stop here. So next time we are going to use this one pi effective action to see how we can address the various infrared problems in conventional string theory using this one pi effective action. Yeah, I think next lecture will go in next Wednesday. In the order of sometime. And then there is something going on here. In which case you will try to move on for angles.
So the alpha prime that you see where in that
thing? Alpha prime is basically inside this. Because we are using these L0s. So alpha prime is essentially in the momentum. All factors of k square carries actually alpha prime times k square. So you make conformal transformation. See, in defining this, you have to make a conformal transformation respect to the choice of local power. So when you make a conformal transformation, what appears is the alpha prime k square combination. Similarly, in the expression for L0 plus L0 bar inside QB, there is an L0 plus L0 bar. Right? That is a part which is oscillator part. But then there is also a k square part, right? So that k square actually is alpha prime k square. So basically, whenever you see k square, right, or you see k momentum, you replace it by square root of alpha prime plus k. That's what I'll do.
How do you go about, you know, proving that claim?
That this claim?
Yeah. In the sense that, rewrite the 1 pi curly bracket in terms of loop pieces, but then honestly use the corresponding conditions for the loop curly brackets, right?
No. So that's the point. We are not going to rewrite this in terms of the loop pieces. We are going to use the fact that when you take, for example, this, take a vortex like this, right? 1 pi vortex, that is problem by. So this involves integration over certain region of the modular space. Okay? R bar integral R 1 pi GML. Now the point is that the boundary of R, R 1 pi GML. This is what is important because the cube is, if you look at the, remember the identity, the cube is acting on the left hand side that converts omega to d omega. And so once you integrate d omega, you are picking up quantity from the boundary of R, right? So you have to identify what is boundary of R 1 pi GML. And there you use the fact that the bound, so this covers the part of the region of the modular space. But its boundary must match up to some other boundary of some other finite matter. Right? Because the section is supposed to be continuous. The full integration is another continuous section. So the boundary of R 1 pi GML must match up to the boundary of some other finite matter. And those in this case can be S channel diagram or T channel diagram or U channel diagram.
So the boundary matches with non 1 pi pieces.
Yeah, the boundary matches with this is as an S integral over here. So the S equal to 0 boundary of that plus S equal to 0 boundary of that plus the S equal to 0 boundary of the U-channel diagram.
But these vertices are again 1 pi vertices.
Exactly, these are again 1 pi vertices.
Okay, perfect.
So that's why you relate the boundary of RGI 1, R1 pi GMN to the boundaries of other combinations of other 1
pi. I basically take this curly bracket and use the QB action on that and put the boundary of D of W and show that.
Exactly.
Okay.
So you have Q acting on each of these, right?
And then use that old identity.
Yeah, that becomes D of omega, then you. Yeah, so you use the old identity to convert to D of omega, then that becomes the integral by Stokes theorem integral over the boundary of R of omega. And then you identify the boundary of R as coming from some other factor.
So that's the origin of how 1 pi came about. But use this method to.
Exactly. So here, the only. Fact about 1 pi that you are using is that if you take the 1 pi and draw three level graphs, it generates a full integration here, right? So there is a boundary left. So the boundary of 1 pi must match up with boundary of some other three level graph.
Yeah, but like proof of this claim comes purely from this thing and the old identity.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
Not referring anything to how 1 pi.
Yeah, well, these are the old identity, but also that the boundary of. If this was a full vortex, for example. Right? Then the boundary of this 4-point vortex will also match, I mean, involve, for example, graphs like this. Right? This will also have a boundary, right? Which could match,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, or for
so
example,
this,
say 6-point vortex. I think that's the usual thing. So consider a graph like this. See, this integral is again from s equal to 0 to infinity. Right? Infinity is a regular boundary, but s equal to 0 is an artificial boundary which has to match up with something.
Yeah.
So one of the boundaries of R GML would have to come from this.
Yeah. Because it has boundaries from all general.
Exactly.
This R 1 pi has boundaries
from all general, right? Yeah.
All general.
Yeah. So
at the 3 level.
At the 3 level, yeah. So the point is the fact that R 1 pi, the 3 level graphs involving R 1 pi generate the full amplitude. That is what is being used.
Yeah.
Right? Besides that, those are identities. Right? So, this is topological information that what is the boundary of R 1 pi. Right? That is the one that you get from other 3 level graphs, but never boundaries of this kind. Right? Because you are not going to use these graphs using the 1 pi vortex. Right? You are not supposed to include loop graphs involving 1 pi vortex. Right? So, this is not included once you. Is 1 pi vortex. That is the reason why the 3 level identities that the phi satisfy okay, is also satisfied by the one pi hypothesis. Okay, because the rule for building the full amplitude from the elementary vortices is the same for 3-level and 1-pi vortices. But it is not the same for the actual quantum vortices. Okay, because for actual quantum vortices, you have to actually draw the loop diagrams. Okay, so RGMA doesn't satisfy this. Yeah, so that will come here also. There will be 0 plus b0 bar. Okay. But just topologically, this is not there. If this had been there, right, then the boundary of RGMN would also include extra terms, which are the boundaries of these. Right. But these are not there because 1 pair vortex, when you are using 1 pair vortex, you don't include these terms. Right. They are only part of the 1 pair diagram. I'll put your definition. So the elementary vortex will have boundaries of this. But because the 1 pi includes this, okay, those two boundaries will cancel. Then the elementary vortex will stop, but this will take over in the definition of the 1 pi.
Again, gauge fixing in DB was like choosing some Lagrangian sum magnitude?
Well, that's also part of DB quantization rules. Right? When you go through the full DB quantization procedure, all of these come together. That you introduce the Bose from the beginning, right, in terms of fields and antifields. Okay. Then you correct the weather also from the beginning. Okay. And then you are not supposed to integrate over the full space of fields that you introduce, but only over Lagrangian sum. Okay. And the whole idea of BB quantization is to show that the result of the integral doesn't depend on which Lagrangian sum manifold you choose. Okay. So in that sense, the choice of Lagrangian sum manifold is like gauge fixing. Okay. But in this explicit example, you saw that it becomes like gauge fixing, right? Because the choice B0 plus psi equal to 0, right? I didn't talk about any gauge impedance or I don't know the action, right? But I talked about the symplectic form. So there, the choice B0 plus psi equal to 0 picks up one particular Lagrangian sum. Right? And that's what you integrate over when you try to make connection with the standard string field for the finite rules. But for general BB quantization, irrespective of string field theory, this is part of the story. Okay, that how you choose the action, what relation has to satisfy, right, which is the statement of gauge invariance. The fact that you include the fields, antifields, ghosts, and everything at one go, okay, including connection to the measure, and that you the choice of gauge corresponds to choice of measure.